Okay, everybody. Well, we're gonna start with our next talk now. It's called The Lazy Red, When Hunter Becomes Hunted, by Vlad Kostruyak.
Thank you. Thanks, Tonimir, for the laptop. Those red teams really trust each other, right? In short, I will talk about some of the mistakes, or let's say when red teams become lazy, or attackers, or whatever, and how you can take advantage of it. In short, I will talk about vulnerability, how to exploit it, how to actually exploit it to detect further, and so on, and also about legality of these issues, right? Where you draw the line between is it legal or moral, and if it's not. I hope I will do it in 30 minutes. In short, I'm actually CTO in Diverto, doing like information security consultancy, standard things. Also, we are hiring, of course. I don't want to talk too much about me. I want to talk about, for example, these ones. Anyone used web shells here? No one. Oh, there is something like these ones, right? Everybody. Almost, right? For those who didn't use the web shells, it's typically something like this, right? If you have some kind of vulnerable web application, you would actually take something like this one, and you usually place it on some vulnerable application, and then an attacker can actually execute the commands on the vulnerable system, right? There are different ones for PHP, for Java, for so on. I guess you all are familiar with something like this ones, right? Oh, it hates me. But it's standard one, right? You have some kind of form where you actually submit the command, and in the backend it actually gets executed on the server. And that's how actually attackers keep access to the server which he owned in some other way. It doesn't matter right now how he owned, right? Or, for example, this one is JSP, right? Same thing. You are taking some kind of parameters and sending it to the command shell of the operating system, right? So you have even the smallest ones. For example, this one is a really short one, right? There is also like for ASP as well, and there is one very good one. For example, I like really this one. It's like hard to actually write the signature for this one, right? You don't have too much things, so you can catch it on, right? In short, if you ever used that web shell, this is how it usually looks like, right? You can like execute standard shell commands, but via the web, right? This is what the attacker does. He just runs something like commands, right? And even on Windows as well, right? But if you use Windows, when you type something like this one, you actually get some kind of output indented, right? Have you ever wondered why? Actually, if you look at the source, everything is great, right? You get the formatted and you have pre-formatted tag here and everything is right. But if you inspect the elements, you actually see that this dir HTML tag is actually being interpreted by the browser. What that means, right? That means actually that he's indenting it as a directory tag, directory list, per HTML. What that means again? That means I can actually insert any HTML statement, right? Just need to make it file name or dir name or whatever, and then I can actually insert to the attacker different like HTML entities, right? The problem is I have file system issues. The problem is most of the HTML elements, if you want to make it proper ending, you have to end it with a slash, right? That's the problem, because usually on Unix and Linux systems, the slash is actually a path separator, right? So you cannot just do like make directory or make file name with the slash. So that means you cannot like specify like something like this one, have it as a file name or a directory name, right? Is there any HTML tag which does not have to end with slash? Anyone exploiting cross-site scripting?
Yeah, images, right?
So you can actually say something like this one, and you can make a directory or a file name with something like this. What this will actually do, it will insert like image element, right? You can actually play with the attacker and put some kind of nice image. That's not so useful, right, from the defending side. You can actually put some unique ID. For example, I just generated this one with PWGen, with PWGen. And then you can grab logs, like access log and error log, and then find if somebody actually raise the alert if somebody accesses something like this one, right? And then again, you can actually detect the attacker itself. Right? So this is how it looks like when he tries to exit to LS if you make such file name, right? You put the bad boy PNG on the web server, you put the directory name like this one with makedir, right? And then you can actually give something like this one, right? Okay, I told you it's not so useful, right? Because anyway, you actually just playing with it and you actually want to know who accessed it and why, right? Another thing is you can actually insert, of course, like JavaScript. There is one neat trick when exploiting cross-site scripting is that you can actually say attribute on error. So that means if you cannot load this image and it's like empty one, so it will not load, execute this JavaScript, right? So that means actually I can execute JavaScript now, right? So I can actually execute any JavaScript the browser will take and execute it, right, on attacker side. So that means I can enumerate his browser, everything, right, what can JavaScript do, right? I cannot access the history, but I can navigate to the history. I can actually see referrer, his like, uniquely fingerprint the browser and so on, right? So this is just a proof of concept, right? So now I'm executing like JavaScript on the, his web shell right now, right? This is just alert. But there is another thing which usually what the attacker does, right? He usually looks at, for example, what groups there are, right? What it does, actually, it lists like a group file name, right? So that means you can actually make new group one. And for example, in this example, I'm actually telling him here I can actually use slash, right, inside the file name. So I can actually say, come on, use this source from the like keylogger and just execute on this one. So that means why I'm leaving this bareware data here? It's because I want that it nothing looks too much suspicious to him, right, or her. So once I have it in the file, when attacker executes something like this one, he will not see anything like it's happening, right? The groups are here, everything, but beside this one, the keylogger.js is actually executing, which is like keylogging everything he types. Now it is getting much more interesting, right? If he pasted something which he doesn't want to, and if he tries to type something, I can see everything what he deletes and so on, so you can get better identification of the attacker and his intents and identity, right? So even with the another thing which usually attacker uses is also like getting all the users from the password file, right? So why not make some other hook here, right? For example, we can also take advantage of the beef. In this example, for example, I'm actually hooking like beef, like which is browser exploitation framework, so I can actually like play with attacker redirected to different pages or to other like exploits for the browser, and then I can exploit the browser and maybe see what's happening, right? So this is kind of now interesting. Because the attacker, nothing's, for example, we sent it in XFS, right? Attacker sees nothing here, right? Still the beef is running beside, and here how it looks like from my defender point of view, right? I can see somebody is actually executed the shell and actually executed my JavaScript. Now I can play everything like with commands and proxies and network and so on, right? So that means I can actually now do whatever I want, what Beef supports. I guess everyone who actually exploited something with Beef and inserted Beef knows what is possible with JavaScript and what's not, right? Yeah. The problem is here are legal issues, right? I'm not a lawyer, first of all. But I can tell you what usually lawyer says, and it depends, right? On the local laws, on regulations, and so on in different countries, right? The problem is you are basically like exploiting vulnerability on attacker shell. And the problem is where do you draw the line, right? Are you taking advantage, for example, of his web shell, on the other hand, or also you are like redirecting to browser porn, so you will exploit it. So, right, now this becomes more, let's say, problematic with the legal side. So this is kind of problematic side. So the problem is also like where to draw the line, right? If you like, if you talk with some people, some will say, okay, I will draw the line, I will exploit his web shell, right, because it's vulnerable. The other things, okay, I can exploit the browser, I don't care, right, but from the law side, probably it's problematic, that one, right? Maybe exploiting like web shell is like gray side, because anyway, for example, if the attacker, for example, tries to connect unencrypted and send something and you sniff it out, it's also vulnerable because it's encryption, but you are taking advantage of it, right? It's on your play field, right? But exploiting his browser, it's really like going to the dark side, right? The story is actually how to fix it, right? It's standard fixing of cross-site scripting. You have like OWASP resources how to fix it. In summary, you have to escape HTML before displaying the command output, right? That means actually displaying before taking the output of the command, just like do the standard HTML escape, and then the web shell is not vulnerable to this one. So it's easy from fixing, right? And also there are some things when it doesn't work, so you have to be aware. The problem is, for example, you cannot execute, like, of course, JavaScript if somebody have JavaScript turned off, of course. But still, you can have like a image tag, right? And the image tag some special ID. And with this one, you can actually attack the attack, right? This is also useful info. It's not just not usual, right? So you can actually get the image tag and then get more, right? Especially if you can put like image tag to point somewhere where you can enumerate more about the attacker, for example, his referrer and so on, so you can actually get where it's coming, right? And also, this will not work, of course, is when attacker is using like some kind of automated things like curl or wget or any other like scripting language, because they will not interpret the output, right? So it will not interpret output of JavaScript. So yeah. So for example, here is like running with curl, and you can see, of course, this one bad boy. And usually, if you do it in the browser, of course, it will be displayed, right? So this is not like 100% bulletproof, but it actually helps in exploiting lazy ones, right? I can also. Show you. I can actually tell you that what I've come so far is that I was looking at different web shells, and most of them actually have this problem. So that means like portlets, standard like command wars, ASPs, PHP, JSP, you name it, right? Most of the shells are actually vulnerable to this one, so you can actually detect the attack when it's happening, if you make some proper placements on different file systems. So for example, what usually attacker do is like running ID, right? And then you can make, if it's running ID, right? Then you can actually have like etc group, right? So it will be displayed. So when attacker runs like ID, this will like run stealthy keyboard, right? You can put in password, other things, right? Other items, and then you will detect the other things, right? So you can actually have some early detection that something is going on and not wait that the attacker is there for ages, right? So let's wrap it up. I will not spend too much time here. Is it 0 day in web shells? I don't know, probably everybody saw it before maybe, but I didn't see anyone talking about it. So I wouldn't say it's like 0 days or hundreds of 0 days in web shells, right? Yeah, it's only cross-site scripting, but actually it can be really used to fingerprint more and gain more knowledge about the attacker. If you're a pen tester, Red Teamer, yeah, fix your web shells. If you're telling the customer to actually do their things, right, and you're not doing it, you are not really trustful, right? So yeah, it will be good to fix your web shells. If you are app developer, blue teamer, that means that you have like some new way to actually detect the attacker and actually gain more knowledge about it, right? So you can actually get, you can better fix it when you know where it is, how what he done, right? Than just being in the dark. Thanks for listening. Any questions about these all things? Yeah, we have one question over there.
So I upload the web shell and I execute it, and how actually do you inject your HTML in the output? Do you use a web app, firewall or something like that?
How do I inject?
Your JavaScript that will, okay. Your code actually, the image tag or something like that.
Yeah, sure. So the question was, how do I actually execute my JavaScript to the attacker web shell? So let's say, for example, this is something that attacker uploaded to the web server, right? And you can see here that it's actually executing system command and actually displaying everything to the user, right? Or let me give you some other example. We can have like JSP as well. So you can see it's taking command and displaying the output, right? Everybody who done some Java knows, okay, he's using like runtime, get time exec, right? Executing the command, and then it's outputting, right? And here is actually critical part. That means it's displaying the output without filtering out the HTML. So if I can make the command to actually, when he types something, display some kind of HTML, this will be also interpreted by the browser, right? And in this stage, I can actually make some of standard commands which attacker will run, like ID and so on. I can actually, for example, here make directory with this one, with this name, right? This is actually directory name. It doesn't look like directory name normal, but I can actually make it on Linux system, right? And once he executes this command, this will actually get executed by the browser because output is not filtered, right?
Okay.
Standard process scripting.
So,
yeah.
So you just plant it in the directory structure, in the etc file, in the password file, or something like that. That
yeah.
Would be normal.
I'm putting different artifacts to actually execute different artifacts, HTML artifacts to actually get executed, so I can detect it better.
Yeah. Right. Cool.
Any other question? We have over there.
The question is, can the attacker exploit, initially inject his shell, even if the web server serving has disabled certain commands like run shell from PHP and stuff like that? Can Java, is it a JavaScript only vulnerability independent of web server?
Let me see if I understood the question. So if you, for example, disable
on most web servers like Apache and Nginx, there is an option in the web server that disables executing like in PHP ini, for instance, you can disable certain functions like run shell
system, and pass through and so on. Okay, the question was
can attacker exploit inject his shell even if the web server says no, you can't execute these commands or this?
Well, let's say that if you disable it, it's much better security, but there is always ways to bypass it, right? You can sometimes you can load like PHP library which you can actually then execute the command which you implemented by PHP, or some other commands which maybe it's not. For example, you enable disable system, but you forget to enable disable pass through or any other command, right? The other thing is this one helps actually if you have also maybe you disabled every function which is possible, right? Which is for executing system commands. But these artifacts actually doesn't help only in web shells. If you leave these artifacts, it can actually help you in local file inclusions as well. And local file inclusions, you will not disable opening files, right? And if you're not doing proper filtering, you will include other files. And if attacker actually executes, actually opens the file and displays etc password file, right? Through local file inclusion, this will also display these artifacts as well. So it will also help in this situation, not just in exploiting web shells. It can help you also in local file inclusions or any other problem where you get the data from, for example, files, right?
Okay, thank you.
You're welcome. Any other question?
So if the attacker has JavaScript disabled, is he safe, more or less?
So the question is, is attacker actually safe if he disables the JavaScript? Let me go there. Where I am? Oh, here. He's actually safe from executing the JavaScript, but he's not safe in detection phase, right? Because you can still have image tags where you can actually early detect that something is going on, that somebody included the file, right? So even with JavaScript disabled, you can have image tags and detect that something is happening, and then you can dig more and find out what's happening, right? This is also good early detection. So no, I would say attacker is not safe with having only JavaScript disabled.
Thanks.
You're welcome. And we have over here. Oh, is your root password
So one interesting, just if I can comment this, usually when you look at attacker infrastructure, security people who don't do offense and defense will be pretty lazy to do correct defense on their offensive tools. And we saw this in major campaigns being carried out. So one piece of logic would be, if you're doing pen tests, if you're doing security auditing, do not use that bind shell. I saw people using and leaving bind shells or web shells somewhere. It's not difficult that somebody might find them, a couple of Google queries, and you might have serious problems. So if you're doing this, keep in mind always to keep security tight, authentication, authorization, all of the stuff that you should be doing in defense for your clients too.
I'll just say thank you. Yeah, I agree. On this one, the problem is here, stick with, if you are doing something like security auditing or penetration testing, do the things right, and then you will not have this problem, right, at all. So fix your web shells, in short. Any other question? Oh, we have another one here.
So would you recommend for the defense using both root jail and the landmine that you have just described?
Well, this is just one of way of detection, and I think the lecturer before me also said like some of the concept, that means defense in depth. So that means this is just one of layer of the defense. Like jails is another one, right?
I mean, this is
application
not
is another one, yeah, and so on.
This
so
is not exactly defense. I mean, if somebody has stolen your passwords, they yeah. have. You will be aware of it, but they yeah. already have them. I would prefer to have a root jail,
okay.
where I would have bogus passwords okay. and the landmine, so they can trip it.
Yeah, what you actually see, I agree, right? This is just if other security controls fail, you have early detection. This is not like ultimate protection for the application. This is something I, yeah, it's good to actually mention it. Regarding the jail, yeah, this one is also like, let's say not running in the jail, but it's running in C group, right? It's a Docker environment, even in this one example, right?
Yeah.
So yeah, that's all a good security practices, I would agree, right? Yeah. And if you look at this one, it didn't actually get the password. It actually gets
True.
Only like usernames. It's password file, right? And it's inside Docker, so he doesn't help too
yeah.
much, right?
Which is so using Docker is a new layer
yeah.
of security.
So
yeah.
the good approach is actually having like defense in depth, and this is just one security control which can help in detection.
Yeah.
And there
Thank
is
you.
Very large. like tip of the iceberg what you should do with the application itself, infrastructure and so on, which is really beyond of the scope of this lecture. It's pretty big. And the previous lecture I actually mentioned a lot of these security controls which should be implemented, right? So any other question? If not, I will
sorry.
Okay, we have another question.
Hey. So I'm also a little bit pedantic about leaving backdoors on the client's infrastructure, and I was wondering if you have looked into the Weavely or Weebly, or one of these two. It's a PHP web shell that comes with a Kali Linux, so you execute a couple of commands, it will create an obfuscated PHP file that requires a password, so that's always good. And since it's not the typical web shell, I haven't looked up exactly how it works, and I was wondering if you have looked inside of it to see if it will also trigger this small JavaScript landmines that you've used.
I think so. The question is if I have looked at Weavely and such shells, right? The answer is actually if you are having some kind of automated way. So that means if you are like generating shell, for example, for Metasploit, and you are accessing with the Metasploit,
yeah.
With Metaproprietor or whatever, right?
Yeah.
Or any other like which is not executing HTML tags, of course it will not work, right? But if the shell is only obfuscated but still like executing all the commands and not filtering the output, it's vulnerable. So half of these like shells are really vulnerable, which I found so far.
Yeah, okay.
I didn't make any statistics. Maybe that's the next step. I'm really not sure, but usually most of them are vulnerable. So we can like take I don't know, some kind of great samples and then make our statistics and make which ones are not.
Yeah,
I don't know if it will make any use, but only I would say it would help attackers.
Okay.
Or maybe penetration testers. Right?
Yeah, thanks.
But I hope they can actually fix it. Yeah.
Good one. Thank you.
So I don't know if you have more time, but okay, we don't have any more time. So if you have any questions, I'll be here, like drinking beers and so on. And you have actually like you can contact me also on Twitter. This one is zero, so feel free to contact me and we can discuss it also about any other web shell. I'm really open to discussions and trying. Thanks.